There shouldn't be a time when you come into the church that somehow it should be a board game, and that could be B-O-R-E-D or be both ways, bored and boring, whatever you want to say. It should be something where application is made, where you've got to force yourself. And today's lesson is going to be kind of challenging. I want to tap into your ability to take hold of all the research I have done for one concept, which will build a doctrinal principle. And from that, we can deduce a multiplicity of things as the readers, the intended readers or hearers, would have understood, and how we are to understand and apply them to ourselves today. So, it is great wisdom. The Apostle Paul prayed in the Ephesian letter that those people reading and hearing the letter he wrote to them, that the eyes of their understanding might be able to receive this incredible insight and information to illuminate their souls. And I think that is a timeless prayer, that the eyes of our understanding, that we may be able to take some, there are no new truths, but take something from today and leave with a greater understanding. So, that's the principle of what I'd like to accomplish today. Now, that sounds real easy. We're going to see how this unfolds, because only God can help. It's only God that can make the pathway with ease here. I didn't bring it out with me, but one of the commentators, Thomas G. Long, in his interpretation, which is very short, the opening in his commentary is very short, but he said something that piqued my interest. He called the opening of the book of Hebrews, he likened it to a tuning fork, you know, used for an instrument, and then there's that, the sound waves that resonate. And I love that, because indeed that's where I find myself in these opening verses. There's a whole, from my perspective, there's a whole symphony of theological understanding in just three short verses. Sometimes people go to church and they are in the church for 30 minutes listening to a preacher, and there's not an ounce of theological understanding, but just in three verses in the opening of Hebrews, there's this incredible symphony that, if one will take the time and not be so fast as to try and race through it, which I sometimes am guilty of doing, and you are as well. But as I cataloged last week, in these first three verses, and you can read them on your own, because I've got to focus in these three verses on one particular concept today, but we encounter the absoluteness of Jesus as God's last word to man. You know, when somebody comes up and tells you about some other revelation or how they receive other revelations, you can always go back to some certain principles, which, by the way, are, this opening passage right here is a confirmation of the whole book. He did speak to the fathers through the prophets, and we have the record, but he hath in these last days spoken to us by a son, and they deliberately leave out the. In the Greek, there is no definite article. It is to juxtapose that through one voice of an eternal Son, a final declaration was made. He is indeed the Alpha and the Omega. We don't need to add to the alphabet, do we now? Jesus reveals himself as that. But we have here God's last word to man in his Son, Jesus Christ. His sonship, his heirship, his creative agency, his effulgency, his perfect being, his administration, his expiation, exaltation, and then we have a sense of completion, that he has sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. And I'd have you notice that there's no period right there. In fact, it goes on. I just elected to just look at these three verses by themselves. In these three verses, something, just as I read it, I said, I can't pass this up, because I know many of you are like me. You read things and you're so familiar. The pages of your Bible have your tears and your saliva and cookie crumbs and everything else. You've read these so in such a familiar way that some of these concepts may no longer leap out at you, but as John Wright Follett said, sometimes you reread things, and they do, by, I believe, the power of the Holy Spirit, they do leap out at you afresh. Here in this passage, I want to highlight one concept today, and that is, it says of Jesus that God appointed him heir of all things. Now guess what? If you go by too fast, you might say, and so, what's the big deal? And this is why I said it's opening up a door to show you, highlighting, in fact, one word in all of this. I'm actually going to highlight the concept of heir. The fact that the writer tells us of all things is a bonus, but he's heir. And in the book of Hebrews, you will find, and I wrote them out, trust me, we will visit them as we encounter them. But in Hebrews 1:2, 1:4, 1:14, 6:12, 6:17, 9:15, 11:7, 11:8, and 12:17, you have the repetition of this word heir, inherited, inheritance. It's repeated. Now, in the Greek, we'll have one word, and this is a combination of word study, it's a combination of everything to drive home a point, which seems at first blush, we might say, laborious. But when you begin to study the Bible beyond just reading, you're going to look for words that reoccur. And that's what I did here, noticing that in this particular case, the concept of heir or inheritance, we've got to be mindful that this is a letter addressed, epistle to the Hebrews. You have got to understand the concept of this word as the readers, we'll call them Hebraeo or Hebrew Judeo Christians. That is, they formerly were a part of the temple worship and all the practices, so they understood all this, but they are now Christians. And the risk here is that they are potentially sliding back, just like at Galatia, they're potentially sliding back to their Jewish ways, if you will. Now, this is not a book about, as I said, my religion is better than yours. This is to show how incomplete the Old Testament closes. In that perspective, we're not saying we are superior to these people. Only God can talk about his superiority. We're just all creatures, same, taken from the same pile of dirt. How's that? My dirt's better than your dirt. But what I want to really drive home, now there's many words that are reoccurring here, and I was going to give you a handout, and I said this is way too much, TMI, too much information. So I'm just going to tell you a couple of the concepts that we will encounter over and over and over again because they are so steeped within here. We have, for example, the word better 13 times in 12 verses, blood 23 times in 20 verses. I'm trying to show you the emphasis here on certain words that the writer intended to repeat and den in. Covenant 21 times in 18 verses. Faith 33 times in 31 verses, God 71 times in 66 verses, and Jesus 14 out of 14. He's got the perfect record right there. So, when a word is being used, sometimes we have to stop and ask ourselves, don't act as though you are so familiar with something as an English reader that you will not stop to ask, how would this first church, how would these readers have received, now my focus is on the word heir, how would they have received and understood this word in its initial use? Now, this is where I'm asking you to hold your brain, because I haven't done this in a long time, and for some people, I know those people who are not linguists and grammarians, you can just sit there and go, oh, vanilla, chocolate, pistachio, all the flavors, count them all. I really want you to listen. This is where you educate yourself. You You've got plenty of other time to do mindless, what I call mindless spiritual exercises, the aerobics of whatever it is you want to do. Here is the time where you are going to bear down a little bit with me. So, this word, heir, we're going to look at its origin and its development to probably do more than just one thing. But initially, we have this word that, going back through the Old Testament, which obviously is in Hebrew, and then into the Septuagint, which is that translation of the Hebrew scriptures into the Greek in the 2nd and 3rd century BC, because Greek was the language, lingua franca of the day. It was spoken everywhere, thanks to Alexander the Great's conquest. So we have here the Greek here of Greek of the Septuagint, and then on into the New Testament. And what I first want to do is I want to start here, because the use of this word as the Greek mind would have understood it. We have, and I'll write it phonetically for you, we have the word kleronomia, kleronomos, kleronomio, and all of its endings, all of its declensions in the Greek. For the word inheritance, heir, it's all the same word. It's either going to be a noun or a verb. Right now, that doesn't concern us. I'm not going to grammar you today that much. Maybe. But like anything else, you go back to the root. Before you can talk about the fullest meaning of a word, you go back to its root. So clero, as a root, in the Septuagint, has, in fact, we can go back behind the Septuagint. We can look at the time, say, for example, of Homer, where it would be translated either a lot, clero, not kleronomia, a lot, as in a lot of land, or a lot as in what is inherited, what is bequeathed, what is, and here's why I wanted to look at this word briefly, because the Greek will then take this word for lot. In English, we have many uses for the word lot. It'll do the same thing. Thanks a lot. Much. Hey, did you see the car lot over there? Hey, that's just my lot in life. You can see that this word can be used for a myriad number of things, to describe, to... So we have the same concept in the Greek. And as this word is being translated from the Hebrew, here's where the good stuff begins. We have certain words that the Septuagint is just going to take and use as one and its full-length kleronomia. These Hebrew words will give us the insight and the perspective and the understanding as to what these people, the intended recipients of this letter, how they would have understood the concept of heir. So, first, in the Hebrew, we have one word. I was going to do this way, but we'll do it this way because I have people here that are doing Hebrew. So, we'll... Gural. That sounds kind of gross. Gural. That's one word. Second word we have is... Yeresh, that's the second word. And then the third word is, oh, I want to write it this way, Nachala. 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 And this should be Yeresh, depending on what vowels you put underneath. So these are the three main words. And what began the petals, if you will, in my mind begin going when I see these words, because I begin to pick them apart. And certain things are bringing immense clarity to a concept that we're just very glib about. We're just, you know, heir, heirship, inheritance, big deal. But in the Hebrew realm, I want you to take note of something. Here we have this first word here. I'm going to look at it. I called it two, but this first word here, it's first encountered when God speaks to Abraham, or Abram, in the 12th chapter of Genesis. And he tells him, get out of your country, leave your kindred, and I'm going to show you a land. Go into that land. I'm going to show you that land. And then later on in verse 7, Genesis 12, 7, he says, and this is the land that you will inherit. Now, it's kind of interesting because later on in Genesis 15, we have Abram. God speaks to Abram and says, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And then Abram says something kind of startling. Remember back there, we see chapter and verse. A few chapters ago, God said, you'll inherit this land. Then he says, what will you give me, seeing I go childless? And the one that's in my house, this Eliezer of Damascus, he's my only heir. And God says, he will not be your heir. First time this is used. It is alluded to in Genesis 12, but the first time it's used in Genesis 15, he will not be your heir, but one that comes, a seed that comes from your loins, will be your heir. Now, why this word is so interesting is it's also going to be used of God promising land, land and seed. And, you know, some nutbag out there who's into the prosperity and the seed, sowing your seed, she talked about seed today. Yeah. Except not that kind of seed. Leave it alone. What is so staggering about this word? See, these, believe it or not, normally it's the Greek that's so precise. This time, the Hebrew offers me some precision, which is really kind of funny. Because this word, I'm going to read you the definition out of Strong's, and if you want to note it down somewhere, you can read in your own time somewhere. If you have a Strong's, you can look it up for yourself. I have here, this is, should be page 4. Here we go, here. Yeresh, Strong's 3423, to occupy by driving out previous tenants and possessing in their place by implication to seize, to rob, also to inherit, to expel, to impoverish, to ruin, to cast out and consume. So when God said something like this, speaking, you got to get what's behind, what's so mind-boggling to me, is God's promising land that, in fact, if you read carefully in the account, Abraham walked in that land, and then he left it and he sojourned into Egypt. Hello. Don't ask me what that's about. But God even tells him, you're not going to have this land, but four generations down, after they come out of bondage, they will take hold of this land. This land will be their possession, their promised possession. And so we have this word being attached to heir, as in what Abraham had in his house, his possessions, and it says he had great possessions. And it is also speaking of land. Now, when it speaks of land, I want you to catch the idea that when it speaks of land, the land was inhabited. We know that when the children of Israel came to the border, there were already inhabitants, and God said, see, look over there, I'm going to give you that land, but you've got to drive out some of the enemies in there first. So I love God's humor. So when you read this definition, to occupy by driving out previous tenants, you're going to see a difference in what we're just translating heir in the Greek to this other word, nachala, which is absolutely to inherit, to take possession of, to obtain by lot, or indeed by inheritance, has the idea of patrimony and promise all tied into it. There's no seizing by force, whereas this has that picture right there. So I want to make that clear. And then what about this word right here? Gral. It sounds so, I don't know. It is, the definition is, a pebble, a lot, small stones used for that purpose, portion or destiny as if determined by lots. So when they cast lots for, if you remember in Jonah's case, they were casting lots, this is the word that is being used. So we have three main pivotal words. And what will be so amazing about this is that we're going to start to see the Septuagint really didn't make any clear distinction. But a word will develop from clero, which is, as I said, lots, portion, to kleronomia, inheritance, or kleronomio, to be inherited or inheritor. And from a Hebrew perspective, if you were receiving this letter and you were told that Christ hath been appointed heir of all things, the hearing of that word heir, even though Greek was the language spoken of the day, and you would hear heir of all things, kleronomia, somewhere back behind here in the minds of these listeners, these words become alive, because in the Hebrew mind, to be heir of something fundamentally required that you either by law of primogeniture, law of firstborn, familial, but there was some attachment. You just didn't inherit something randomly. It's not the way the Hebrew mind and the Hebrew language even works. So what struck me as I'm reading this is the use in the Septuagint of first kleros, and it'll give you a picture. The kleros, not kleronomia, kleros, just lots and portion, appears 129 times. The bulk of which, let's see here, the bulk of which will be these two words, and not so much this. When we get to kleronomia, this word drops off the map, and the bulk of the uses will be these two words. And so, as I was reading this, I said, you know, there's an enriching way to pick apart something. As I travel through the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Hebrew text, I begin to see certain things that then sharpen my mind as to why I should pay attention to what happens in the New Testament. First of all, for example, it is said of the priests, of the Levites, they are the kleros of the Lord, and they are also his kleronomion. They are his lot and his inheritance. They had no portion in the land. And as you keep going through the scriptures, you see something radical changes. From the promise of the land, which the big thrust of which God spoke, God's word, God's decree for land, that then once you get into the book of Joshua, which opens with the command for Joshua to lead those people into that land, something interesting happens. The nachala, the inheritance, begins to change focus from a land to people. So that by the time you get into the Psalms, you're reading that for the large part, the people have become the nachala. The people have become the focus. The land was the land, was the promised land. And you know, if you talk to the Zionists, they'll say, and yes, and there'll be a time when, and I'm not even discussing that. I'm speaking of how this change occurred to where, as you read, it's navigated from the focus of land, seed and land, to God's treasure people, his prized possession, his inheritance. Now, nowhere in the Old Testament, nowhere do we read that we are, if we were only looking at the Old Testament, that we could deduce somehow that we are the children of God, God is the Father, and somehow we are the inheritors of his inheritance. We could not deduce that from a Jewish frame. I want you to, I'm trying to like shake you a little bit, put some information and shake it down a little bit more until it settles. From a Jewish frame, you couldn't get there. There's no mention of it. That's the first most staggering thing. So the fact that this word heir is reoccurring in Hebrews, that got my attention. Now, why does it become important for us to know the backdrop of this into the New Testament? Well, it seems self-evident that in the New Testament equivalent, they cast lots, for example, for Jesus' garments. We know it has to do with this. It's nothing to do with these concepts. But as we begin to navigate into the New Testament, I'm going to give you the definition that kind of won me over to pursuing this word. Kleronomos, the heir, in the sense of a person named in a will or in a natural sense. Kleronomos is used for the one who actually possesses or controls entrusted goods. Kleronomia, the portion which is to be or is inherited, inheritance then, is simply the possession. But then it becomes property of. Now, let me give you a perfect case in point. When Dr. Scott made his last will and testament, he said to me, to his wife, left A, B, C, D, and G. And in that A, B, C, D, and G, I used the example of the copyrights to his teaching, giving me that, giving me the right to essentially play God with that, do whatever I want. Although he and I had a large discussion about what should be done, which I have subsequently carried out to the best of my ability. But it giving me the license to essentially do once I have taken possession of. This is a law that is not just in the Old Testament or a concept in the New, but it is applicable to us today. Once something has become property of, it is my property. Now, we're not talking about in the big picture right now. We're talking about in the frame reference that I'm trying to make a point. It is my property to do what I please with. Does that make sense to you thus far? Okay, now, that is not too far from the biblical concept in the New Testament of Christ being heir of all things. And it's almost like we race by this concept. We hear, oh yeah, he's heir of all things. He made heavens and he made the earth and the Lord is the Lord's everything. Everything that's in the earth, it's all his. And you know the scripture, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. That's all wonderful. But if I'm pursuing this framework, it becomes clear to me that Paul, the Apostle Paul, in his writing, will pick up this word, kleronomia, especially at Galatia. In the fourth chapter of Galatians, he picks up this concept. And he wants those people to know and to understand that their participation, their activity is not because of the law, it is because of faith. And they have become, until the law, and then it says when faith has come, and now. He was trying to hammer away the crust of the law and to say that Christ, he became a curse for us, and in the process, we have become sug, put the prefix there that he does use both in Galatians and Romans, sug, that is the prefix, the Greek prefix with. We have become co-heirs with Christ, and he will develop this even sharper in Romans 8:17 to make a point very clearly that any Jewish listener would be jarred at. How do you become an heir? And specifically, the heir that we are speaking about is the heir of a promise and is the promise of life eternal. When we say Christ has become heir of all things, I want you to stop for a minute and realize that if the scriptures are true, and if indeed, as the scripture says, we have become by the spirit of adoption, we cry, Abba, Abba, Father. My association with Christ makes me co-heirs with Christ. He is heir of all things. I'm co-heir with him. Now, come back to reality for a minute, to your daily bubble, where all your problems are, where your life looks like a pot going somewhere. And I want you to remember that no matter how little you have or how much is crumbling down or how much you may have in this world, it is dim in comparison to the inheritance of the all things of this verse. Now, I'm gonna try and do this without killing this whole, because there's probably 20 messages in here, and I'm determined that I will put this down as a pathway for you and for I to remind ourselves not only of a doctrinal principle, but of a fundamental application. See, I could stand here and preach and maybe bring a word that would bring such encouragement for a moment, for 30 minutes, for an hour after it's done, that you're, yeah. Or I can lay down a principle which is immovable, unchangeable, never deviating in its process. That when your life, when you start internalizing and looking down and away from God, you realize, wait a minute, time out. He's heir of all things. I've become his son or daughter through my simple faith in him, and therefore I too am an heir. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about how much or how little we have, and in the big scheme of things, it matters not. Because the big principle that's being said here is, he is heir of all things. He has all things. The Father hath, Scripture says, the Father hath given all things into his hand. Now, some of you are looking at me like I got three heads. Like, you see, yeah, okay, yeah, I know that, big deal. And others of you are, I can see some of you are thrilled. You're just, your heart's like, wow, all things, wow, all things. Yes, all things. And that's not being carnal to get excited about that. Now, why this concept will be very meaningful to us here, and I'm getting to it. I said we wouldn't stay in Hebrews. I will come back here, famous last words, but I want you to turn somewhere with me. If we are speaking of the concept of inheritance, many people, especially in the Pentecostal charismatic realm, they get carried away with what God's going to give you right now and how God's going to give it to you, and it's going to be abundantly above and beyond what you can possibly. But the word inheritance, I want you to see, is something that has been purchased or handed to or legally assigned to. And in the New Testament realm, this is what jarred me, is referring to the hope eternal, life eternal. So, when we think heir of all things, our mind may race to many mansions and this thing over here, and we're talking about all these material things, but there's one principle that is being driven at again and again and again. Now, to the Jewish mind, if I fail to do this, the rest of this will fall apart. To a Jewish mind, to a Jewish thought process, the concept of inheritance would mean I would have to be not a daughter, because daughters could get passed over, but I'd have to be a son. And it would have to be a blood relative. So the concept of inheriting life eternal to a Jewish listener is radical. It was revolutionary when it was said. It was not probably the idea that I or you, if we were in a Jewish frame, could inherit something of which we technically were not flesh and blood a part of. And then life eternal. Now, you'll see when we come back to Hebrews, you'll see why this lesson today makes the craziest impact on a letter written to the Hebrews. But right now, I want you to turn your Bible to two passages I want us to look at, and they're both in Luke's gospel. One of them, I'll start with the one that you're probably more familiar with, and that is in Luke 18, and we'll work backwards. In Luke 18, remember, all of this heir, the concept of kleros and kleronomia, is to emphasize one thing, heir of all things. Specifically, we're talking about life eternal and the kingdom of God, because the land concept that was engraven in the minds of these people, well, we'll come to that conclusion probably later on, but I just want you to realize that their incomplete revelation becomes completed in every way, shape, and form through the mouth and the declaration of Christ and his authority, which is validated by the resurrection. So, Luke 18 and 18, and we've read this before, but I want you to read it with a different emphasis. A certain ruler asked of him, see the irony behind this. A certain ruler, we know absolutely that this is a Jewish person, a Hebrew person, Jewish person, asking the question. A certain ruler asked him, saying, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now, no matter where your mind wanders, I want you to rivet and latch on to the concept that inheritance in the New Testament has everything to do with life eternal, and the tangible things that we think are important are unimportant. Heaven's full of all kinds of things, but the one thing is you got to get in the door. You can talk about the things afterwards once you're in the door. So open up the mind a little bit here. Here is a Jewish mind asking, good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? A concept that is strikingly, I'd never looked at it this way before, strikingly bizarre, considering the scriptures, there's no New Testament, and what the decrees before the law, Abraham even, out of Ur of Chaldees, understood a concept of inheritance. It had to be of his loins, or one in his house that he had appointed as such. So it seems very simple to me. This is a staggering question. Inherit, what shall I do to inherit? And now we have this concept over here, eternal life. Another concept that is quite ambiguous in the Jewish scriptures. I don't care what anybody says, if you ask five different Jewish people, from a Hasidic Jew to a Reformed Jew, ask them about the afterlife, you're guaranteed 5 to 10 different answers. Why? Because the bulk of Judaism is concerned with how you live your life now. Well, there are concepts of the afterlife, which I will maybe refer to later on. But what I'm saying is inheriting, get the Jewish mindset, inheriting eternal life, it's like two things. It's like an oxymoron. These two things do not go together. That's what's so staggering about the question. And then Jesus says, why callest thou me good? None is good save one, that's God. And here he goes to cite the commandments to him. You know the commandments, don't commit adultery, don't kill, don't steal, don't bear false witness, honor thy father and thy mother. And he said, all these have I kept from my youth up. Now again, I want you to think about the answer that this man gives. Now when Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, yet lackest thou one thing. Sell all that thou hast, and distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me. When he heard this, he was very sorrowful, because he was very rich. Now, the interesting thing here, I want you to see the whole picture, and we're going to juxtapose it with something else in Luke, and then I'm going to come back to make my point, which is staggering, refreshing, and illuminating all at the same time. It's like having somebody throw a bucket of cold water on you, and you're very hot, you're refreshed, you're staggered, you're taken aback all at the same time. This is what this concept should be today. When Jesus saw that he was very sorrowful, he said, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through a needle's eye than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they that heard it said, notice what they didn't say. They didn't say, well, who's rich that can be saved? They just said, who then can be saved? Now, some evangelical nutbags have taken this to mean that all the disciples were rich. Ipso facto, there's no need to talk about this because, you know, that's their logic. But the Greek here is very specific. It doesn't say, well, which rich people can be saved? Now, notice what Jesus' answer is. He says, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. That gives you some definite clue that you cannot work your way in. Now you might say, well, but Jesus said to go and do this one thing. You lack one thing, go and do this, and then come follow me. And people have taken that in the license to become legalists or to take a vow of poverty. But now, let me show you why this concept is important. Flip back a few pages to Luke 10. And if you can, keep your hand at Luke 18 as well, because we'll flip back and forth for a minute here. In Luke 10 and verse 25, "And behold, a certain lawyer," it's always the lawyers, "behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him." Now, don't think, I want you to get this straight, don't think lawyer as in, you know, the guy that says, "I'm an attorney" on TV. No. I want you to think a certain lawyer who'd be well-versed with Jewish law. Get the perspective. "He stood up and he tempted him." Now, here's a man who is well-versed with the law. How's this to jar your mind, who is obviously also a Jew, familiar with the law? Jesus couldn't possibly, in his eyes, be God, because the law says, "Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." He stood up and he tempted him, saying, "Master, what shall I do?" See, notice both of these ask, "What shall I do?" The mindset of works, that I must earn my way, and what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Keep in the background that this word "all the while" is a possession obtained. He said unto him, this is the cleverness of this. Jesus asks the lawyer back, "What is written in the law? How readest thou?" I want you to see that between the lines is a little editorial on my part. Very crafty that Jesus did not let himself be tempted by this man. He's God, but he does not let himself be tempted, because he could have answered him, but instead he makes him say, "Well, what's your interpretation, essentially, of your law? How do you understand it, lawyer? Give us your expertise here." And he answered, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself." Now, I want you to notice that in the previous passage I mentioned in Luke 18, we have Jesus quoting the commandments and the scripture, and here we have the man reciting them. "And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live." Now, both of these, both Luke 10 and Luke 18, have to do with the concept. They both came and asked, "What shall I do?" And to the people who do not understand this, they'll say, "Well, of course, Jesus said, do this and live. Go sell these things, and then you'll be in with the rest of the club." But that is not at all what is underneath the underpinnings of inheriting eternal life. He goes on to recite and tell the man this parable about the Good Samaritan. And the reason that Luke includes, and you'll find in Luke's writings a lot of inclusions of, other Gospels have it, but Luke has the most of Samaritans, who were the most disdainful. They were rejected by the Jews. Anybody else hated them. They were enemies of everybody. If you were a Samaritan, that's pretty bad. And yet, what is being said here is preparation to show how someone outside of the Torah and the law and the understanding could act as a neighbor, unbeknownst. Now, if you're only looking for that as an answer, after Jesus tells him the parable, he asks him, "Now, which of these three, the Levite, the priest, the Levite, or the Samaritan, which of these three was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves?" Because the man said, "Well, tell me, who's my neighbor?" So hence the parable. And he said, "He that showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said unto him, "Go and do thou likewise." Now, here comes everybody in the marching band of Christianity saying, "Now get out and do." But something is being said, which both in Luke's gospel, right before the 18th chapter that I just read, and in Mark's gospel, the same thing will occur. Right before these men appear and ask the question, "What shall I do to inherit?" Jesus both in Mark and in Luke, we have the account of the little children being brought forth. And Jesus says, except you become as one of these, you can't enter into the kingdom of God. Now, these men are worried about how to obtain it by a human realm, by works, by endeavors, by good deeds. But Jesus says, except you become as one of these. Trusting, absolute confidence that when Jesus said to the children, come, they came. I made some notes on this because it was so staggering in my mind, but there's something else that is the most interesting thing about this. Both of these men, and in other instances, they're asking the same thing, which fundamentally, I think, at some point in our lives, we will ask the question, is this it? If you haven't come to the knowledge of what's in this book, is this it? So these men coming to ask this question, whether it was tempting, or whether it was indeed to find a way to obtain by not having to part with their goods, something is summed up in the two that Jesus is pointing out to both of them, that the law and the instructions thereof, no man could do, no man could carry out, and therefore would make the concept of life eternal and inheriting that life eternal impossible by their method and by their means. Hence, I go back to these Jewish concepts, because these were both promised by God. When we talk about the promised land and the promised seed, we can be sure of one thing: inheritance and possession was not because of a certain personality trait or a certain character. It was the word of God spoken as a promise, as an oath, guaranteed to the people as God gave his word, this would be their possession and they would be his possession. Now, I highlight this and I tell you this for a reason, because as Jewish readers, now go back with me to Hebrews, as Jewish readers, as Jewish listeners, hearing this most staggering thing, that God hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things. I could forget about the rest of the verse and the rest of the verses that I've been looking at to just highlight this one thing. The concept of this word is so, it is so stamped on the New Testament that to a Jewish listener, it had to become clear that there was only one way to inherit or to become a co-heir. The concept that I just referred to, the children, except you become as one of these. And then you'll read on in Hebrews that Noah and Abraham are both, they're chronicled as having obtained an inheritance, one of righteousness and the other one because he obeyed God, both having obtained an inheritance. These both, by the way, before the law, before there was any conditioned mindset regarding the law, and yet these obtained how? By faith. Now, we have, the book is, a much better group of promises. We have a much better concept of this. Now imagine sifting all this information, and somebody has had to recount a little bit of the things that Jesus has said. There is no New Testament circulating. And the few things we could know, the few things that are indeed mind-boggling, Jesus talks about a future judgment. And in that future judgment, he says he's going to gather the goats and the sheep together, and then he's going to begin to separate. And to the ones that he has sorted out as his and his possession, to the Old Testament people, deeds of righteousness, to the New Testament, fathers, imputed righteousness, he says, well, you might as well turn there. I made you turn back to Hebrews. You might as well turn there. You're going to be looking at the scripture in Matthew, I think it's Matthew 25, so you can see it for yourself. And you can see how staggering the big picture is. Yeah, it's Matthew 25 and let's start at verse 31, because this will wrap it up for you and tell you how important this word and this concept should be to us. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him. Then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations. Some people have gotten confused, and this is only this group of people, but you'll read with me, and we'll study in the coming weeks, that alluded to in the opening chapters of Hebrews is Psalm 2:8, where it says, "Ask of me, and I will give you the heathen nations for your inheritance." That's a messianic psalm speaking of the rest of the people that are Christ's, that belong to him as his inheritance. "Before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another as the shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats, and he shall set the sheep on the right hand, on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come," an imperative, not just a slight beckoning, "Come, ye blessed of my Father," there it is, "inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." And by the way, that word inherit is the same word we've been looking at this whole now nearly hour. Come and take. He's not saying, would you like to take possession of your possession? He says, come take it. It's yours. Not permissively, but definitively and imperative. Take it. Seize it. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Now, you can do whatever you want with this, but the one thing that should be crystallized in your mind is while we fuss down here about how we're going to get by, and I'm not discounting that, I'm not telling you, oh, don't worry about that, because no, you unfortunately, you're going to be worried about that, even though Jesus tells us don't be anxious about these things. The Lord knows exactly what you need. But while we're busy fussing about who can add a day, or as the scripture says, a cubit to your existence, who can add anything, but rather when things don't look as good as they should, I pray that the focus will be when things are good, you're reminded of this too. But when you seem to think that everything is sliding around you and the hope and the perspective seems fuzzy, I want you to get into this one word I've just looked at and sear it in your brain, that your simple faith as one of these coming, there is no, the child doesn't say, how do I earn my wages to get in, but rather the child came, and I'm sure just simply childlike faith. Yes, Lord. That when everything else seems to be falling apart, you will remember this word. And remember the honor and the privilege while the world, and I'm going to say this carefully, the hedonistic Christians out there and the playland for Jesus people that are busy telling the saints how to get it now and how to feel good now, in my Christianity, which is, I look at the Bible and I see myself there, the writer of Hebrews says how these things come to pass, by faith, it says, and patience, but rather by faith and makrothumias, long-suffering, are these promises obtained, the one singular promise that is given to us as heirs of salvation and life eternal. Want the last word? Because the last word is by the same man who wrote about, in the beginning was the word, and the last word comes on this word out of the book of Revelation. Revelation 21 says, he that overcometh. Come on, I know you want to read it. Y'all saying Revelation 21, verse 7, he that overcometh shall inherit all things. I will be his God. He shall be my son. That's the last word right there. Now, for you who are a little shaken today and came needing a little assurance, this may not be the quickest way to get to an understanding of blessed men go through or tough shoes for a tough trip, but it is the surest way to forge in your mind that through it all, and no matter what you traverse in this lifetime, it is the overcomers. And how did they overcome? Even the book of Revelation says, by faith. So the underlying principle here, Jesus Christ, heir of all things, you know, people worry about, am I going to die poor? Am I going to die, you know, how are things going to be for me? Well, I always say this to people that ask me, make your will. Don't let your will be dictated by the state, which if you don't say who, you play God at that moment. If you don't say who's going to be the person that you assign and who's going to do with and whatnot, the state comes in. It becomes the state's money, essentially, to do what they see fit to do. But don't fuss about these things either. You might say, well, that's easy for you to say. Well, wrong. Coming from a mind that I had to explore, not just in this one message, but this is years of exploring and coming to an understanding about something that you can have. Boy, I'd like to use some colloquial stuff right now. You can have all the things. You can have all the things. And you can still be absolutely empty and have nothing. The concept that I have something greater than Aunt Clara's will and what she's left to me, something that is immeasurable, you cannot calculate, you cannot even imagine, the human mind cannot even apprehend the riches to the fathers that await them, whose mind is fixed on him. So when you come back to the book of Hebrews, and when we return eventually, I want you to remember that one word. You're going to encounter it again and again and again, and there is no achievement. Just as the children of Israel, it was a God-given gift to them. Whether they understood that or not, it was a God-given gift and promise. Here, how much better a promise do we have? Not of earth, even though Jesus says, the meek shall inherit the earth. But keep reading on, because I'm told of a much better place than simply just the earth, but the kingdom of heaven that does await every single believer that has faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's my message. You've been watching me, Pastor Melissa Scott, live from Glendale, California at Faith Center. If you would like to attend the service with us Sunday morning at 11 a.m., simply call 1-800-338-3030 to receive your pass. If you'd like more teaching and you'd like to go straight to our website, the address is www.pastormelissascott.com.